Hi, Jemma.
Hi, Lisa.
Thanks for joining me this afternoon. For those that don't know you, can you introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about your involvement with the creative arts?
Yeah, sure. So my name's Jemma. At the moment, I'm currently a venue manager for Base Camp, which is based in the centre in Middlesbrough. And Base Camp is a creative venue that deals with all artists from all backgrounds. We try and keep it local because we are very much into keeping local talent and having it accessible for all. So we deal with musicians, we deal with artists, dancers, you name it. We deal with all the creatives, and I'm there liaising with all these people trying to make the magic happen.
Terrific. That's what we like to hear. I love that policy, you know. I think keeping it local is that we've got so much talent here. We don't need.
Oh, it's so important to keep it local, and it's so important for it to be accessible for all as well. And at the moment, we are going through our disability plan. We do have disability access in the building, but we're hoping to get some funding to make our building even more accessible for everybody. So that's really exciting as well for the future.
Yeah, brilliant. I mean, the last thing that I put on out in the real world was at Base Camp, the Red Room, back in February.
And what a fantastic night it was.
Yeah, it was. And again, like, you know, I'm very concerned with the accessibility, which is why we had that ridiculous play staged with all the lines projected behind us on the screen. And, you know, I know you do what you can. So you had your ramp so Adrian could get into the building. And I'm really pleased to know that you're focusing on that. It is important.
Oh, definitely. Definitely. Very important.
So apart from all the stuff that you do down at Base Camp, You have all kinds of stuff on the go of your own. So can you tell us a little bit about your individual practice?
Yeah, so my individual practice as an artist, I deal with a lot of things to do with sex, how people view sex and how people view the naked body when it's exposed. I'm very sculptural with what I do. I like to be very physical and hands-on. And also I like to put a bit of performance into my work. So the latest project that I am working on at the moment, which I'm hoping to get out next year, is a build-up from the last piece I did for my degree show, which was called Ultraviolet. And I'm now going to go in to do Ultraviolet Reloaded. So basically it was all about the act of penetration. So I built this big box, and with UV sticks, I was inserting the sticks into the box as the box was moving round, all in the dark and UV. And it was all about the act of penetration. So sometimes I'd be putting in sticks rougher than others, slower, and just kind of all about the act of penetration, really. It's just about looking at sex in a different way. And to me, sex is a very important thing in my life. It's something I'm addicted to as well. So I like to be able to express how I feel about sex in maybe less of a bleh way, so people aren't exactly like, oh my God, she's mental. Just subtle tones, but also getting to people to think about the human body and the human form. And yeah, so that's my practice, really. It's all a bit kinky.
Nothing wrong with a bit of kink. There'll be no kink shaming here.
So yeah, that's something I'm working on, and I'm hoping to get out next year, definitely.
Terrific. So have you always been involved in the arts? Did you come from a creative background?
Well, as a kid, I never used to play out. I used to hate it. I used to be stuck in the house with me Pritt stick and me glitter and anything else, fairy liquid bottles, you name it. And my mother would be going, there's paint on my ceiling again. There's paint in the sink, having a nervous breakdown. So I was always really creative. And then I left school and I got into the whole sex, drugs, rock and roll lifestyle. And I did that up until about 29. And literally just lived the wildest life, and then suddenly matured, as you do, and realised, oh God, I'm so creative. Why have I never done anything with this? And I was getting tattooed a lot at the time. And my tattooist, I brought in some drawings to show me tattooist just so he could know. And he was like, my God, you're really good. You've got a skill. Why don't you start tattooing for us? I was like, oh my God, really? So I started working as a tattoo apprentice in 2011, and that started my love for art again. And then I left tattooing about 9 years later and went to work in an arts cafe in Richmond. And I met the proprietor, a woman called Lou Gilmore George. She's an artist. And she sparked so much passion and in my life. And it was just me and her running this arts hub in Richmond. And she said to me, Jemma, have you ever thought about going to uni? And I was like, no, I can't do uni. Look at me. I'm not cut out for that. And she was like, Jemma, you're the perfect person for uni. She was like, just apply. So I applied. And the next day I got a reply back and then went to uni. And then 3 years later, here I am. I've got amazing connections. I've got an amazing job. I'm within where I want to be. I'm so passionate and it's opened up so many doors. And I thank my friend Lou, who I had that art cafe with. I think she got me back into where I needed to be.
Terrific. Yeah, sometimes it just takes that one person to have a bit of faith and confidence in you to inspire you.
Oh, definitely.
Like you say about university, it's like, you know, it was never even, like, no one in my family's been to uni. It was never
same.
Even. And I didn't think I could, I had no idea I could go to university. It was only when I was like a recovering mother, had two kids, and you know, my whole life had kind of been, I was like earning a lot of money, doing a lot of creative things, living in London, leading all the, you know, as you say, leading the life. And then all of a sudden I'm kind of like a stay-at-home mum in the middle of nowhere. It was only after that, like, suddenly someone said go to university.
Yeah,
what?
That was my face. I was like, you what? I was like, I'm in my 30s. And they were like, so?
Yeah, absolutely. And as you say, totally, totally life-changing experience.
Oh, definitely. Best thing I've ever done. Best thing I've ever done.
Yeah, I encourage everyone to do it now.
It's the people you meet. The connections are the most important thing. Never mind your grade or what you do. It's making them connections. It's so important. And I think university gives you such a good one for making connections.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's talk about that. It's like you say, like, as you've always been interested in the arts, but you never saw it as something that you do for a living or something like that. So what do you think, other than like an end product, like a show or a book or something, or like a job in the arts, what do you think is about the arts? What is it? Why is it important to people? Why do people do it? And what do you think it does for society as a whole?
I think art is about personal growth for everyone. And if you're growing in yourself, you're growing into the community as well. Because with art, you're looking around things that are going on around you. You're taking in what's going on in your environment and you're creating something in that environment and giving back. And I think it's really important for people to be creative, especially nowadays where everything seems to be turning really digital and it doesn't seem like we're going to be coming out of this for a long time. And I think it's important for people to still keep a hold of the physicality of life. And even people that say they're not artists, we're all artists. We all have that creativity. And when people say to me, I can't draw, everybody can draw. It's about mark making. It's about being present with yourself. And that piece of paper. And I think it's really important that people are able to express themselves. And some people don't have the confidence to speak out, like me, who are really a confident speaker. And some people might want to get things across that they can't say in words. And it's their way of communicating. Also, especially with people with disabilities and learning difficulties, it's such a key thing to have these people creating, because that's sometimes the only way of an outlet for some people. And it keeps communities together, it keeps people that are creative together, it brings people together. It's so important. It's so, especially like I said, in this digital age, I can't say enough that people just need to just pick up a pen and paper and just doodle.
Absolutely, couldn't agree more. Or pick up a camera, you know, whatever.
Anything, yeah.
Pick a couple of things together.
The kids Play-Doh, anything.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I guess that brings me on to the last question, which we have to tackle, is lockdown. How's it affected? I mean, obviously it's had a big effect on your work. As manager of base camp tell us about the things that you've been doing down there anyway, because I know there's still been loads going on behind the scenes.
So some of it is top secret, obviously we can't let out, because we have got some big things in the pipeline for when we do reopen. Obviously we were lucky enough to get a lot of funding for the Cultural Recovery Fund, so there's going to be a lot of changes, a lot of developments, a lot more accessibility. We're also going to get a kitchen fitted So a hint of food in the pipeline as well.
Substantial, I hope.
Yeah, but it's going to be all vegan, locally sourced products as well. We're also redecorating. We started the redecorating in the last lockdown, but now we're putting finishing touches together to the building. We're also in talks with a lot of artists, music artists, and we're getting the diary filled for next year for some amazing big events, if we can go through. So we've been planning and scheming behind the scenes, boxing things up into packages, putting them on the shelf, ready to come out when the time's right. And just tightening things up as well. A lot of staff training, even though staff training is not the way we kind of say it in base camp, it's more of the family getting together and just making things better. So yeah, it's just a time for us all to come together, and we're getting some real good ideas in the pipe. I can't even tell you, Lisa, this is the thing, because it's all secret. I've got so much I want to say. But Sidecar Studios as well upstairs, that's going to get a bit more of a revamp and a bit of a, I can't say too much.
So that's, yeah. Sidecar Studios, that's quite new, isn't it? It's your kind of music.
Yeah, that's our music studio, yeah, upstairs, based in base camp. Unfortunately, that isn't disabled friendly at the moment, but we have got plans for a second studio to be put in the building where it would be accessible for all as well. So watch this space for more studios.
Terrific. It's been an absolute pleasure to talk to you. I can't wait to get out and see you again, and we will.
And you, Lisa, I can't wait to have the red room back.
Oh man, we're not gonna just raise a glass. We're gonna raise bottles.
Oh, raise a whole bloody keg.
We're gonna have our head replaced by a couple of optics and just,
yeah.
That's what we're gonna do, proper style. You take care, and I will.
Thank you, Lisa.
Hopefully, sometime soon.
Take care, my lovely. All the best.